we are always trying to create a world that we can live in, a world that we hope will bring us safety and stability, a sense of peace and orderliness, and a world where we can have opportunity, where things will improve, and a world that fits with our ideas of how we want to live. A world that will give us the feeling that I can do something useful, or I can be creative. So actually, we have a lot of expectations of the world that we are hoping to create. But that world that we are trying to create is very elusive, because the daily world is very volatile. Our day-to-day world is very volatile because things always change. And nothing, almost nothing, holds the place that we assign to it. You'll say, oh, stay there. But the world is not like a puppy that we can train and then it becomes obedient. Maybe that's why we like puppies and dogs. Despite our best plans, life brings us unwanted surprises. Something unexpected interrupts or threatens our security and our expectations. There are a million ways this can happen. A storm comes and a tree falls and cuts a power line. And that means we can't use our computer and we can't complete the project we're working on for a client. And then they become upset. Or we can't make dinner because there's no power. Or we're coming home from work and the traffic backs up. And we miss a meeting. Or maybe somebody doesn't keep a promise that they made to you. Or somebody says, oh, I forgot to do what I said I would do. And then your hopes and your plans are jeopardized. So when these kinds of things occur, we naturally are disappointed. And depending upon how we are, we can lose our composure, and we can lose our tolerance, and we can lose our compassion. We're always at risk for those kinds of things in a world that's full of surprises and changes. And it can be so threatening to our sense of well-being that centuries ago, the ancient religious leaders, the ancient spiritual people, they advised their young acolytes to stay away. Stay away from all the business and all the temptations of the world. It's too much. Live secluded. Live simply. Be undistracted by all of that. And they gave this advice to the young monks and the young hermits in order to help them gain their freedom. Freedom from desire, freedom from attachments. They stay away from all that. There's too much that can go wrong in everyday world. Stay away. That was the advice. That was the spiritual life many centuries ago. But very few of us can live that way. Very few of us want to live that way. We don't want to live away from society. We don't want to be part of families. We want to be friends. We want to function in the everyday world. We want to find our way in life and pursue our own interests in the midst of all that. We want to be actively engaged in the life of society. We feel the need to be with others, not separate. We don't want to separate ourselves from others. Because we feel that's how we are going to understand who we are, not isolating ourselves away from each other, but being with each other, that's how we're going to understand what's going on. So here we are in the midst of all this, changing, dynamic, sometimes threatening world, where we have to train ourselves to find the mind of equanimity in the midst of the world of ambition, in the midst of a world of confusion and change. Not isolating ourselves from it, but being part of it. So the secret is in our practice, of course. Our practice of making a good effort to keep our mind on what we're doing in each moment. Forgetting about what we want for ourselves. Forgetting about our own opinions. In other words, we are trying to not allow our mind to be distracted by our desires. Because when we get lost in that, when we get lost in the wanting and the lusting, we lose our equanimity. We lose our balance. And what it means to lose equanimity means to feel threatened. But if we look carefully at the subtleness of this feeling of threat, we discover it is only the idea of a self that is threatened. Our comfort is threatened. Our careful plan is threatened. If we look carefully, we can see that's what the threat is all about. So our practice is to train our mind to become more and more subtle so that the mind can become aware of the mind. To notice when it is starting to feel disturbed or threatened. To notice when it feels the emotion arise. And then make the effort to return to equanimity, to a quiet, empty mind. And just pay attention and just listen. So we know that the world that we live in cannot be 100% stable or maybe 50% stable or 70 or 30, I don't know. But the world always has a high degree of instability. It's always changing. There's always going to be some confusion, and there's always going to be some disorder in our world. And that means there are no easy answers to help us build the kind of world that we want to live in. There are no easy answers to complex questions. It's quite natural for us to want to have easy answers. Answers that are easy to understand, that explain everything, that leave no doubt. Because then we feel we can use these answers just like medicine to cure our problem. Or we can use these answers as if they were a habit, so that we have no need to think. And we can become very comfortable in calling on our easy answers to take care of anything that arises. It's very natural to want that. But that's just one more form of desire. Maybe the most troublesome. That may be the most troublesome desire we have. The desire for easy answers to complex issues. We think that if we can only have easy answers, we will find equanimity. No more stress, no more confusion. No more mistakes. Easy answers, we think, will give us equanimity and peace of mind. But that peace of mind will become easily disturbed because there's no such thing as easy answers. As we know, there are no such thing as easy answers. So if we cling to fixed ideas about the way things are or the way things ought to be, that's not equanimity. Holding on to easy answers, holding on to fixed ideas is not equanimity. Because the clinging, the holding on to those ideas, the holding on to those supposed answers only leaves traces in our mind. And so we are always in anxiety. Even if we think we have the answer, even if we think we're carrying around the answers to all questions, there is anxiety. It means we're always in anxiety. I think it turns out that easy answers are not really what we want, even though we think, wouldn't it be nice to have easy answers? Wouldn't that be a blessing? I'd love that. Actually, that's not what we want. If we look carefully at ourselves, we see that's not what we want. What we really want is the capacity to respond to disorder, to respond to change, to respond creatively to instability, to respond with equanimity. We want to be able to respond to the disorder and the confusion of the world with the mind of practice. That's what we want. So we really need to accept the truth that there are no such thing as easy answers. And to train ourselves to be ready to live with uncertainty. With a mind that's ready to explore complexity and the mind that's ready to accept whatever comes. A mind that does not hold on to ideas of ourself. Then surprises or criticisms are not threatening. And this readiness is equanimity. And as Suzuki Roshi said in his book, it is the mind of readiness that is wisdom. A week ago, we had a unfortunate incident here, a burglary where some valuable things have gone missing. And we met on Saturday to talk about it, and I feel that our collective response was pretty good. There was no panic in the room. There was no fault finding. There was simply careful consideration of what we have to do to respond. And the responses that we came up with started almost right away. Nobody sat around. And we are on our way to full recovery from what we've lost with some work, but we're well on our way thanks to the efforts of a number of people. I felt our response was from a mind of equanimity. As you know from your experience, the mind that we have in Zazen is a mind of calmness. Well, sometimes. Most of the time. The Zazen mind is a mind of calmness, without complexity. And you can feel it. You can feel that there are no traces when you have Zazen mind. Oh, there's nothing there. Ah, wow. No traces. And when we have that kind of mind, we are not being carried away by our emotions. Zazen mind isn't so mysterious. It really means that we have dropped off preconceived ideas of ourself, so that there is no self to be defended. It is a mind that is not setting itself up in relationship to other things or other people. And that is a limited mind. And a limited mind cannot find equanimity. After Zazen this morning, some of us went over to have coffee together and just chat a little bit. And one of the things that we talked about in a lighthearted way was competition. Competition in the Zendo. You know, like when we first come to practice, we sit and I've got to sit better than this guy over here. I'm not going to move because I want to show him that I'm better. And we laughed at recognizing that that's how we are when we first start. And that's not a mind of equanimity. That's a very limited mind. And we very quickly come to recognize that. And we soon drop off any notion of competing with somebody else in the Zendo, which is a pretty good step forward, actually. So, in Zazen, we just sit without wondering how the other guy is doing, or how we're doing in compared to this other person. When we sit in Zazen, we just sit, and we continue that attitude in the everyday world. When we do something, we just do it. And we let go of ideas of ourself within the doing. There is what we will discover with practice, that there is no need to be too proud of ourselves for what we do. And we come to understand that this pride leaves traces, which in turn lead to selfish ideas, which only complicates life and fills us with delusion. So I don't know where the saying came from. Maybe the Bible, maybe not. Pride goeth before a fall. So I don't know. Does anybody know where that came from? But I don't think it's Buddhist. It came from somewhere, but it's quite true. If pride enters into what we do, it's the beginning of lots of trouble for us. Fortunately, our practice will show us we don't need it. It's not necessary. In one of his writings, one of his talks that has been written in the Shobo Genzo, in one of Dogen's talks, it says, not leaving a trace or a mark, birds in flight are impossible to track. Leaving clear, distinct marks, both a wagon passing down a muddy lane and a horse in a field are easy to track. A bird, however, does not need marks to follow the birds that have gone on before. And this is our practice. And it seems like this is a mystical world, what Dogen is talking about. It's ineffable, ineffable, ineffable. It cannot be known. We cannot explain how birds know when and where to migrate. And we don't know, we cannot explain how we ourselves know something before we think. We think and some idea appears. And we don't know its origin. Our true nature is like the birds. It exists before thinking. And it exists side by side with the relative world, the everyday world. So it means that our mind does not need to rely on traces. The mind does not need to rely on certainties and easy answers. Our mind already understands the inherent nature of things. Just like the bird knows where the other birds have gone without even seeing it. The mind, if we give it a chance, knows what it is and knows what it is doing. The mind knows where it is going. And within that mind, there is peace of mind and equanimity.